Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to Grace. It's so nice to see everyone here. And for those of you here, those of you joining us online this morning, we're glad that everyone is here together to worship and celebrate our Lord together. If you are new to Grace or if you're visiting, we have connection cards that are in the back of the pews in front of you. If you fill that out and put it in the offering plate or put it up at this table, that would be great. If you've changed any of your information, email, phone number, address, please let us know through the connection card or through the church office. We want to keep you up to date with everything that's going on in the church, especially over the holidays. We have a lot of different special events coming up, and we don't want you to miss out on anything. And if you're visiting today, after the service, come join us over here in our welcome room over by the Christmas tree here, and we'd like to give you a gift this morning. And I hope that all of you had a great Thanksgiving holiday with family, friends. We serve such a loving and faithful God. There is so much to be thankful for. So I hope that you had a great weekend and a great Thanksgiving. And now, as you can see, our church is decorated for Christmas, and we are headed into the Advent season. And at this time, to start off our Advent season, I would like to invite Paul and Jerry up to the front.
Born to us, the Son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness.
And as you see, we have hope in our Savior. And as we move forward today, as we move forward every day through this Advent time when we celebrate the birth of Christ and we look at the candle, and this first candle represents the hope that each one of us have in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you, Paul and Jerry.
Thank you, Paul and Jerry, for kicking that off today. I'd like to start with a couple announcements this morning. First of all, if you didn't notice when you walked in this morning, we have a nice tree over here in our Welcome Center, and that is our giving tree. On the giving tree, there are some tags that look like this. Each tag has something small that you can purchase as a gift for seniors in our community. Seniors that have been identified by the Bristol Housing Authority as having no family or people to celebrate the holiday season with. So what we would like to do is get enough gifts to pack together 50 to 60 gift bags to be able to hand out to these senior citizens right here in Bristol and serve our community in that way. So as you walk out today, take a look at the tree. There's little items on there, socks, games, some puzzles. That's what I picked up, adult puzzles and word games. Just something small that you can pick up and bring back to the church so that we can help our community out in that way. Also on the tree, you'll see there are some tags that have some kids' toys on there as well, because we are also giving out toys at the food pantry to the families that come through the food pantry for Christmas as well. So take a look at it as you walk out this morning. Talking about the Christmas season, all our announcements today are about Christmas. We have a night of Christmas worship again here at the church. If you've been to them in the past, it's a phenomenal time of music and prayer just to get together as a church family and celebrate the holiday season. And that will be Sunday, December 18th at 6 o'clock here at the church. And ladies, there is a Christmas breakfast in Yankee Swap December 3rd, Saturday. Let me hold up the flyer for you. At 10 a.m. at Parkside Cafe in Bristol, down on Main Street. grab a flyer on your way out. This will be a fun time for the ladies to get together to enjoy a great breakfast if you've been to Parkside before. They have great food, great fellowship, and some fun things happening. A Yankee swap if you want to participate in that. So for more information, grab a flyer on your way out. Stop by the tree, stop by the table, and see the information that's up there. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you as we look at our holiday seasons, as we just celebrated Thanksgiving and spent time with friends and family and just focused on the blessings that you have given us and everything that you provide for us. And now as we look ahead to the Advent season, we're just filled with awe and amazement at your plan of sending Jesus to this earth for us. And we just thank you for today. We thank you for our time together. We thank you for our time of worship and our prayer and our time to learn more about you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Had a good Thanksgiving.
Yes.
We're all staying together. As we just heard Jerry read, I was actually going to read it as well today because our first song that we have was about all the names that Jesus has. And as we heard her read, from Isaiah, the Christmas story mentions the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, and it made me think of this song that we used to sing years and years ago. So we're going to bring it back today. The second time we sing the chorus through, we're going to sing all the names of Jesus. So try to keep up. If you can't keep up, the third time you sing the chorus, you can go back to the easier part and sing that part. I'll sing the hard part. Let's have some fun with this morning. Alrighty, here we go.
You are worthy.
Really sounds great. Beautiful decorations and a week's worth of work to get these done. And appreciate everybody who had a part in it and sacrificed and dedicated a lot of time, a lot of lugging of Christmas trees and restringing of lights and hanging of wreaths. So thank you to everybody. We want to celebrate a couple things today, I think, which really shows as we're going to take up our collection in a minute, our offertory, but really what we can do here at Grace. We a couple weeks ago, we sent off our shoeboxes for Operation Christmas Child. We had great videos throughout the period, and we ended up doing, I want to say, 72 boxes. And our friends at Liberty and loaded them onto a tractor trailer as many churches came together. And you know what was interesting is, I know as some of you went out and were doing the boxing, you found that it was very sacrificial to give those boxes, because we know that the prices of everything has gone up. And I really think we gave and we did a wonderful job here at Grace. And secondly, as you may have seen in GBC happenings that went out, we've been doing our sacrificial envelope drive. And we had a goal set before us that was at $5,050 if all the envelopes came in, which is really nice. But you know what happened? Well, there's still some envelopes downstairs. There's a few left. Not all the envelopes have come back, but like $5,400. We went over and above the goal of $15,000. That is sacrificial. And that is something that is, you know, give glory to God, because He puts it on our heart, the Holy Spirit works, and just, you know, thanking each one of you and for really going above and beyond where God has called. Right, so we're so blessed here at Grace. And our ushers are gonna come forward and take up the offertory. We always talk about, you know, we have such a history here of Grace of giving and of working for God's glory. And so many of you have been here and have supported the church, and as we've seen many new faces come in and supporting the church, we are really, really expecting God to continue to do some big things here at the church on the corner of King and Louisiana. And I'm excited, and all of us, aren't we? Just, you know, I'm going to pray over the offertory. We're just going to come to God with just great expectations. Lord God, we just thank you for your grace, your mercy, your presence. Lord, we thank you that we can celebrate this morning the coming of our Savior Jesus, your perfect plan for us. And Lord, as we give of our offerings, we do so with such great confidence that you do far greater things than we can even imagine. Lord, we completely trust you. We placed our faith in you. And Lord, let us give now with cheerful hearts for your glory, for your name. We love you and praise you, and Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Into the scripture, but I wanted to ask you a question. What was your first thought this morning when you woke up? I don't have to yell it out. Don't yell it out. And maybe you don't have any thoughts until you get that first cup of coffee or you start to function slowly. But I want you to keep that in your mind this morning. What was your first thought this morning when you got up and your mind started functioning? And it was interesting. There's a, it's kind of an odd movie. I think a lot of us have seen it over the years. It's a bit older. And there was a character in this movie, Phil Connors. Now, I don't know if you remember what this movie is, but Groundhog Day. It was an interesting concept. But basically, every day Phil Connors, the character, woke up. He was a weatherman, and he was in Tennessee, Punxsutawney, Phil. And every day he woke up, and the day everything was the same. It was just some odd thing. And his day repeats itself, and he gets up. Same day. It's the same day. It's the same day. But eventually he starts to shift. Then he wakes up and he says, well, wait a minute. I'm grateful that I'm here today. And he starts to have a sense of gratitude toward what's going to come. And he takes that sense of gratitude out into his life and into the people around him. Because the people around him don't realize it's the same every day. It's just him. So it's really kind of strange, but he develops an attitude of gratitude as he makes an adjustment in the way he's thinking. And I think Groundhog Day can sometimes really be something that we could look at as we look to, for this time of the year, coming out of Thanksgiving into Christmas, have an attitude of gratitude. And I know you see it out there and you see all kinds of things, but we want to look at it biblically. Because really, isn't it a good time of the year to make an adjustment? It really is. It's a good time of the year to make an adjustment. We're getting closer to celebrating the birth of Jesus. We have that awareness of all that God did to restore that relationship we have. And I think in most of our hearts, we do tend to be more grateful at this time of year. We just tend to have that sense of gratefulness. So I think it's a good time to make the shift and make the adjustment. And we're going to talk about habits. We're going to talk about a mindset. But I want us to get to the main point that we're going to see today, and we'll get into our main text. But here's what I want us to take out of here. Every day that we wake up is a gift that God has given to us. Amen. Well, you don't know what yesterday was like, Pastor. But when we start to make that shift, say every day that we wake up, and that's a gift that God has given to us. You know, originally when I thought about how we're going to do this, my original thought for this was, who am I, Lord? And I still can't sort of get that out of my head. As grateful as I am to all that God has done, I keep thinking, who am I, Lord? Now, maybe your mind goes in a couple different directions, but I was looking at it, who am I, Lord, that you've poured down your mercy and grace on me and your love on me, and that you've allowed me to get out of bed this morning and to serve you. I really, for me, on Sunday mornings, that's always one of my prayers when I come in here early and I just sit quietly. It's like, who am I, Lord, that in a couple hours I'm going to be given this incredible gift to teach and speak your word? So now we have two thoughts that we can put in there. What was our first thought this morning? And who am I, Lord, that I have this great gift today? And that will help to move our hearts a little bit in gratitude, I think, because it's not always easy. Now, as we've talked about in here, we've talked about habits, and it takes either 21 or 22, depending on what studies you look at, to really start to develop the habit, and really more to the point that it allows us to move past the perceptions that we have of ourselves. See, it helps us, it takes about 21 or 22 days to replace the mindset we have about ourselves. Or I can't do that, or I can't stop doing that. That we can start getting the mindset to work. Because initially when we step in, we have a hard time doing that. And then, as we look further, we go to about 66 days when we can naturally do something without thinking. When it becomes just part of who we are. So it's 66 days. That's the average. So for some of us will take longer. Some of us, it's clearly a shorter time. So the first 21 days are removing the perceptions really about what we can't do. And then at around day 66, we're starting to say, this is what I can do, and I'm doing it naturally. And those are habits, or those are expressions of gratitude. That is developing an attitude of gratitude. But to move away and to move into, we need something healthier in which to do. We need something healthier in which to look at. And if we're talking about gratitude, when we first thought we have in the morning, oh, it'd be a bad day. We need to get out of that, and we need to have something healthier to look to. And that's where we can look to God. And here's sometimes the hardest part. As you move out of that perception and into that change, okay, I have something better to look to. Are we motivated to change? And we spend a lot of time when we look at God's Word talking about His desire to change our hearts. See, God has a desire to change all of our hearts. The question is, are we motivated to allow that change to happen? Well, in some places, certainly. Oh, but not there. You see, and that gets to be the challenge. So we want to move to this attitude of gratitude. And there's really three things that we're going to see this morning. I'm going to read our text in a moment. We have God's activity throughout history, which shows us we have the very presence of the Lord God. And so, yes, the Lord God. Do we really understand when we say the Lord God what that means? And then we have to go back and understand who we are. You see, in our text this morning is in Genesis 2, verses 5 through 7. This text will help open our eyes to the change of gratitude that we can have in what God wants. But it'll help us see God's activity, the fact that He is the Lord God, and really give us a better reflection of who we are. Let's read. And that's up on the screen, or we have Bibles in front of you. Genesis 2, 5 through 7. Now no shrub of the field was yet in the earth, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not sent rain upon the earth. And there was no man to cultivate the ground, but a mist used to rise from the earth and water the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. And that is God's word for us, God's people. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for the life-giving breath that we have in us. Lord God, we come humbly before you with hearts that are seeking you. Lord, with hearts that are filled with gratitude. But Lord, maybe in some areas we don't have the gratitude. But Lord, we desire change. We desire a change that you want to do in our lives for your glory. So Lord, open our eyes this morning, open our ears, and open our hearts so that your word may change, move, motivate, completely revolutionize our attitudes so that every day we live with an attitude of gratitude. We love you, Lord, and praise you, and Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Pretty neat scripture there. That really gives us a big picture. It talks about God's activity. And I think when we look at God's activity, we want to be clear that we understand in God's activity there, what has actually happened. But sometimes we have to look at what didn't happen. Because there may well be a lot of ideas that we have about God, about the creative process, about his role in our lives. So we want to be very sure that we understand. But we can look at what wasn't there. And we see as we look at that scripture, no shrub, no plant, there was no rain, there was actually no man to do the natural, to do the work that God has called. There was no us. So we're saying, well, how did all that get there? And we look at what happened and what didn't happen. Because even as we look back in Genesis 1:20, and we see, then God said, let the waters teem with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens. And that just gives us an idea that there is nothing. If God is saying, let this happen, that means God is creating out of nothing. He's creating something. He's created out of nothing that was there, something that is living, that is alive. And that can bring us such a great attitude of gratitude. And even as we look further in his word, and we think about who we are, maybe some of us can think about who we were. We fast forward to now. You also, this is from 1 Peter 2:5, as living stones are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. See, in the beginning, there was nothing. But now look at the position that we're in. We're a royal priesthood. We can honor Christ. We can bring before him things that are acceptable. That's a complete change. That's a completely different story. Because God, in his mercy and grace, has moved us from nothing to something.
Right.
There was nothing. Now there's something. As the candle represents that Paul lit. Hope. There was nothing. Now there is something. And that's so important as we look continually through the story of God's word. God, in his mercy and grace, has looked upon each one of us and made us into something. Because even as you see on the screen in 1 Corinthians 3:9, we are something. We are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. See, that is something we can celebrate. But it is also something that we can take as we celebrate. When we wake up in the morning, the first thought we have is, Lord, I'm something because you made me, because you put me in this position, because you've redeemed me. Lord, you've changed and are changing me. And all of a sudden, the whole outlook on the day can change. See, that's what God desires for us in his grace and his mercy. See, I want to go back, though, to our original scripture in Genesis. Because this is such a critical scripture. It really shows us God's creative sovereignty. We know that God is sovereign over all things. Sometimes we'll forget. Sometimes the world wants to say, well, God's sovereignty is only in some areas, but not in all areas. And this is what we want to look at, because as I said when I started this, what happened and what did not happen? These three verses tell us three things. Two that are not true, and one that is. You see, as we look at verses 5-7, there is nothing there that talks about evolution. Evolution is not true. See, we can see that. Evolution says, it's a theory which says that all living organisms arise from one single living cell. Sometimes evolution, that's really Darwinism. That is not, as we read the creative text of Genesis, what happened. Really, evolution says, a bunch of certain chemicals and proteins were brought together randomly, and here we are. That's how it happened. Evolution is not true. You see, and then as we look at this text, it tells us that there's something out there that sounds really good. It's called theistic evolution. So yeah, that's true. I know I've heard that somewhere. That's true. Well, because theistic, yeah, has God involved, and okay, evolution. Okay, yep, so that must be right. Theistic evolution, I'm going to challenge you, is we can define it as progressive Christianity. Oh, it's a progressive way of thinking. We're thinking a little different. We're thinking outside the box. Well, really, you're thinking outside the book. We don't want to do that. Theistic evolution, again, this is not what God is talking about, because God's word doesn't say that. Theistic evolution is a merging of scientific opinion with the authority of Scripture. What does it say in the book of Revelation about adding anything to God's word? Oh, boy. I see a couple good expressions out there. I like that. Yeah, you see, but that's what theistic evolution. Well, no, this is God and science. God and science can exist together. Well, certainly God and science can exist together. God is right, and he's determined everything, and that's the science that we're going to go with. You see, we're attempting to harmonize scientific theory with biblical truth, and that is just not going to happen. We cannot do that. You see, theistic evolution says, okay, we'll give in that God directed and ordered the evolutionary process. He might have even been involved in producing the first life forms. But now he's not so actively involved. That's another sign of theistic evolution. Yeah, God was there, but now he's stepped back. So he said, well, you mean God's not sovereign then? See, theistic evolution, we have to watch out for. You see, because what this talks about is God's special creation. God created. He is the creator, special creation. And this is what our text points to. It is the biblical viewpoint. In a series of supernatural acts, God created the world and all of its life forms in a relatively short time. See, we're going to have some fun in the upcoming year, that short time. We're going to be looking a little bit at creation as we study some disciplines of God. It didn't happen in a long time. Boom, it happened. God made it. And what that says is, you know, we're looking at special creation is a literal interpretation. It's not symbolic. What happens in Genesis is not symbolic. It's not mythological. It's not based on some ancient Hebrew myths. It is literally what happened, a literal historical fact. So how does that play into an attitude of gratitude, Pastor? We're sitting here this morning worshiping the God who created us all, who in his grace and mercy has given us so much. That helps us to understand all of God's activity in the creative process, that he's had a perfect plan for each one of us. Okay. I always use the words transcendent, yet imminent. Transcendent kind of gets us to understand that God is over everything. He's over everything. That's the sovereignty, yet imminent. But he's not so big, he's not so over everything that he doesn't know exactly what is going on with each of us at every moment. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. God's imminence, his personal nearness, and local involvement in our lives is a critical piece of knowledge that will allow us to develop a greater love and a gratitude for all that he is. You see, God's plan for creation was not by accident. I see Matthew and Luke went downstairs, but I remember I once said, and they remembered it, God didn't say oops. That was a long time ago, I think I first said that. And those two guys remember that. They found it humorous, but humorous? Yes, because it'll stick in our head. But God has planned everything for this moment where we are. And it can allow us to take that gratitude. So as we look at the scripture, we see God's special creation. Now, as we look and the scripture slide comes back up, you'll see in bigger letters, Lord God. That's very interesting there as we look at that. Lord God. It's used in the Pentateuch, which is the first five books of the Bible. It's only used in Genesis 2 and 3, and one other time in Exodus 9:30. And when it's used in Exodus, it says, you do not yet fear the Lord God. So within the Pentateuch, the expression the Lord God is only used three times. And there's an invitation right there, saying if you don't understand, say I've never made the Lord into the only God of my life. I don't know who the Lord God is. I would invite you to make that decision today and to understand when you see the Lord God and the incredible love that he has for each one of us. Whether you're here or if you're watching or if you're listening, let us know how we can help you with that. To understand the Lord God loves each one of us, sent his Savior, Jesus, to die for each one of us so that we can have eternal life. That is something that you don't really know about. Please, let us know. But this expression, which is not just an expression, the Lord God, it is actually a name that will define our relationship with God. Because it combines two words. God, Elohim, in the Hebrew, Elohim is God, and that refers to the all-powerful God. See, that's where God comes from, Elohim. And then the second part, Lord, or first part, depending on how we read it, is Yahweh, the God who is with you. See, Lord God is referenced here means this is the all-powerful, mighty creator God who is with us. See, that's where we start to look at the expression God with us. See, the Lord God, that defines the special, intimate relationship that God desires with each one of us. See, it's a unique relationship that only humankind has with him. Because even as we look in Genesis 3:1, it says, now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he, the serpent, said to the woman, indeed, God has said. You see, there's a difference there. Because the serpent was saying, oh, I understand, God is all powerful, but he is not a personal God to me. And when Eve, further on, when we see that Eve had stepped in Genesis 3:3, and she stepped into, moving out of God's will into the sinful area, she forgot the unique, special relationship that she had with God. And even as she said, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said. You see, at that moment she stepped from God's will, she forgot the unique relationship that we, as God's people, have with him, That he is the all-powerful God with us. Right. And that's so critical to understand right here. We have this unique relationship. The unique relationship that God has established for us allows us to more fully live and grow in a life of gratitude. See, we have to understand that attitude of gratitude can come from understanding that perfect relationship that God has set forth before us. That the Lord God has set forth before us. And even as you see up there, that word for, I have it bigger, I expanded it, because we want to understand this is a gift. This is an action. This is the special creation, the special gift, the special blessing that God has given us in that unique relationship when we say, the Lord God. So we want to see how important that is. Because that word for, it really represents to us that restored, redeemed relationship that we have with God that was paid for fully by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He did it for us. We have a special relationship for us from Him. See, that helps us develop that attitude of gratitude. God's activity. Then that Lord God special relationship that we have. But now it takes us into this point of understanding who we are. Because when we read this scripture, we see a very interesting thing. Then the Lord God, the one who established a special relationship with us, formed man. When we see the word formed as we look through scripture, we have to understand that this really denotes the potter. Because when we think of the word formed, we can start putting our minds into thinking about pottery, because we see this reference throughout. God's hands are the hands of the potter forming us, dust from the ground, into something beautiful, living, and alive. See, that's what God has done for us. Because even as we look, when we understand the creative power of God, you know, Adam, we have the name Adam. Adam means man. But it's taken from the root word, the Hebrew of Adama. A-D-A-M-A, which means ground. See, God formed us. He formed each one of us. He's formed everything about us. He's done everything to make us exactly who we are. And we see the psalmist time and time again, if we look in Psalm 33:15. He who fashions the hearts of them all. He who understands all their works. See, God formed us from nothing into something beautiful and wonderful. And then as you see up on the screen, Psalm 94:9. He who planted the ear, does he not hear? He who formed the eye, does he not see? See, so we understand this forming each and every intricate detail of who you are. You see the picture of the mighty hand of God forming us into who we are. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God formed us in his divine image. Does that make you step back and you wake up one morning and say, I'm going to have a really bad day today? Well, wait a minute, God. You formed me in your image. I can persevere through. Thank you that you've redeemed me, that you've made me, that you're with me, that I'm walking with you. You see, because as we're formed by the Lord God, the all-powerful God who is present with us, he just didn't stop and form. He took the next step. And he breathed life into us. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. Can that help change our outlook in the area of gratitude? I don't have any gratitude. So maybe it actually can that change our attitude. You see, that's what we want to look at. If we fully understand the creative power of the Lord God, you think of the power that is in the creation. That is the Lord who is with us right now. Formed by the Lord God and filled with his life-giving breath. That is who each one of us truly is. Grasping fully the image-forming activity of God on us and his life-giving breath in us can eliminate pride and produce a life of gratitude. You see, the creative process is not just a story. It's not just a myth. It's just not something that is nice to read about. It is what the Lord God has done for each one of us. So I have a couple questions that I want us to consider. I know maybe they're not questions that you like to consider. What are you grateful for right now? What are you and I grateful for right now? Now maybe you're saying in your head, I'm not sure. I didn't really think of that this morning. I didn't think there was going to be a quiz when I came to church. It's not a quiz. It's a chance to say, God, what am I grateful for right now? My Lord God, what am I grateful for right now? I got a second question for you now. If now you're thinking about right now. What were you grateful for yesterday? Well, I'm not really sure. I didn't really consider any gratitude yesterday. I don't have any idea what I was grateful for yesterday. And we think about that movie, Phil Connors in Groundhog Day. He wasn't grateful for the day. He wasn't grateful for the previous day. The previous day before that. You see, God doesn't stop time. God continues to move forward and be active and present in each one of our lives. And I didn't ask those questions that you can say, I'm not grateful for anything. I wasn't grateful yesterday. I just have had an ungrateful year. It's not meant to hurt anybody's feelings. It's meant to help move us all back into alignment with the Lord God, the all-powerful God with us. But then maybe some of you said, well, Thursday, wait a minute, Thursday I was grateful. Because, you know, we sit around the table and we say, hey, what are you grateful for? So I was grateful Thursday. Praise God for that. Because you know what? And we had that feeling. And we had some things going on, we were grateful. You see, we are grateful people. Sometimes we just need the reminder of how good God is and how much he loves us. You see, because maybe on Thursday you had a chance to slow down. You had a chance to focus on things that we have to be grateful for. You see, we always say, well, what's the application I can take? You're just saying, have an attitude of gratitude. But we've entered into the Advent season, and we lit the candle this morning that talks about hope. Slow down. Think of the Lord God who created you in a divine image, who's walking with each one of us right now. Or 22 days to change the perception of ourselves that I'm not a grateful person. God, I haven't been grateful. Today's November 27th. We have a whole month ahead of us. We can start to change the perception. And what a better time as we focus in on the birth of Jesus. Focus in on the birth of Jesus each day with a gratefulness that we can have. Build the habit, change the perception, honor our Savior, and take an attitude of gratitude into each day of our life. Before we pray, I'm going to read Psalm 67 to you. God, be gracious to us and bless us and cause His face to shine upon us, that Your way may be known on the earth, Your salvation among all nations. Let the peoples praise You, O God. Let all the peoples praise You. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For You will judge the peoples with uprightness and guide the nations on the earth. Let the peoples praise You, O God. Let all the peoples praise You. The earth has yielded its produce. God, our God, blesses us. God blesses us, that all the ends of the earth may fear Him. Let's just take time out for the Savior. And as we move toward His birth that we celebrate, I think that our attitude of gratitude will grow even greater. Lord, we love You and we thank You. Lord, some days it is hard to wake up and say, Lord, I have an attitude of gratitude. Lord, but challenge us as a church, as the people of Grace Baptist, as the people who are here watching, listening, Lord, wherever we are. Lord, challenge us to change. You see, Lord, we're going to change the perception we have in ourselves. Lord, we have so much in You. My Lord, my God, all powerful and with me. God with us. Lord, pour Your Holy Spirit down on us. Let us feel Your Holy Spirit working in us. Lord, You created us. You love us. You are with us. Mighty God. Perfect in every way. Lord, we just thank You for who You are. We love You, Lord. We praise You. tells us in the book of Numbers. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. We love you, Lord. We praise you.